All right, now we have built a linear accelerator that also usually call LINAC. It's the first stage of acceleration, but can we use it to go to very high energy? So the system with the tubes that we have seen can give, make about 2 MeV mega electron volt per meter, because we cannot go at higher fields, because otherwise we have sparking between the tubes. So considering that the Large Hadron Collider is it goes to 7 TeV, there's an error here, of energy, then a linear LHC would be 3,500 kilometers long. So it's not a good idea to use this system to build a very large accelerator. What can we do? We need another trick. We have to bend the particles. We have to remember that a magnetic field bends the particles. And this is what we do with our particles. We make them go round. We make them go round because we can use the synchrotron. We can use a circular accelerator where not only we have accelerating cavities, how we call them, but these are basically the gaps that we have seen before, where we give the kick with the electric field, but we can have magnets all around in such a way that the particles are forced to go in a circular way. So basically, using bending magnets, how we call them, magnets that produce a vertical electric field, we bend the particles, and we have bent our linear accelerator in such a way that particles are forced to go around. Okay, nice idea. But there is a limitation. We have almost built a synchrotron. We have almost built a synchrotron. Why? Because, first of all, we have to consider that if we keep giving energy to the particles, they will go faster and faster. No, the velocity will be increased. But if they go faster and faster, the revolution period here will be smaller and smaller, will decrease with velocity. And then if we use one sinusoidal field to give energy to the particles, the particles will never be in phase, will never pass on this accelerating point at the moment when the electric field is maximum. Ah, this is a problem. And then we have to consider that as we change the energy of the particles, then also the radius that the particle will have inside this circle will change. So there is a fundamental problem, but how can we overcome that? Again, Mr. Einstein comes to our help. Relativity comes to our help. Because in a linear accelerator, we have seen that the length of the tubes is proportional to the velocity of the particles. But can it continue forever? Can we have longer and longer and longer tubes? Lucky enough, not. Because what does Einstein tell us? That no particle can go faster than the speed of light. So if we accelerate a particle, we give energy to the particle goes faster and faster. But at a certain moment, this acceleration will reduce, and the velocity will slowly approach the speed of light. So you go asymptotically close to the speed of light, but you will never ever be able to go beyond the speed of light. So why? Because at a certain moment is the mass of the particle that increases. So if you think that during acceleration is like pushing a cart at the speed of light. So you go to the supermarket, you buy something, and then you are late, so you start running in the parking of the supermarket faster and faster. You go faster and faster. Let's imagine that at a certain moment, if you approach the speed of light, your cart will become heavier and heavier. You keep giving energy because you keep pushing your cart, but it will be heavier and heavier. The mass will increase, and the velocity will slowly saturate towards the speed of light. So what is important, what helps us to build bigger and bigger accelerators, is the fact that we want to operate in this region. When the velocity of the particles approaches the speed of light, is very close to the speed of light, then it becomes very useful to build the synchrotron. This is where we can use the synchrotron. And, for example, at CERN we use linear accelerators up to about 50% of the speed of light. about this region. Then we go to a small synchrotron, then to a larger synchrotron, and when we are in the Large Hadron Collider, already we are at 99.99% of the speed of light. We are practically here relativistic. And if we push more energy to the particles inside UHC, basically what we do, we increase the mass. We don't increase the velocity. And now that you have seen that, it's very easy to understand how the synchrotron can operate, because when we are at constant velocity, the speed of light, then the time of revolution will remain constant. We'll be always in phase with the accelerating field. And the only precaution that we have to take to keep the particles into this circular path will be to increase slowly the field in the magnets to cope with increasing energy. Because here, the law of the magnetic field tells you that to keep the same radius, you have to keep increasing the magnetic field, because this is proportional to the velocity, but to the momentum of the particles, mass time velocity. So you have to keep into account increasing the mass, in the mass. And we have built a synchrotron. Great. Synchrotrons can be very big, can be quite small. This is the smallest synchrotron at CERN, a machine which is called LAIR, which is only 78 meters in circumference. You see, so the beam comes from here, goes around. It's almost square. There are only, if I can go back, there are only four bending magnets. So basically the particles come from here, then they are bent by 90 degrees, 90 degrees again. So you see, you can make a synchrotron very small, or you can make it very big, which is 27 kilometers, the Large Hadron Collider. And CERN, you see, at CERN we have a complete chain of accelerators that covers all the, that starts with a linear accelerator, then a first synchrotron, a second larger synchrotron, a third synchrotron, and only at the end the particles go to the Large Hadron Collider. A few more words on what are the technical components of an accelerator. The magnets, as you've seen, are very important. The magnets, because what limits the energy that you can achieve? Of course, what you would like to have is the highest possible energy. But what limits the energy of a synchrotron is the magnetic field, because there are physical limitations. So if you build, this is a normal conducting magnet, a standard magnet where you have a vertical magnetic field and your beam goes in this, your particles go in this direction. The maximum that you can make with this technology is 2 Tesla, okay, which gives you the maximum field. If you want to increase the energy, you have to make the accelerator bigger and bigger. So, and also this is a limitation, I mean physical limitation, how much space you have available and how much money you have available for your accelerator. A solution is to go to superconducting magnets. Superconductivity allows you to make with special techniques up to 8 Tesla for the present generation of accelerators, 12, 16 Tesla for the future generation of accelerators. So superconductivity is a way to make more expensive magnets and accelerators, but to keep their size reasonable, to go to higher magnetic fields, therefore to higher energies, remaining, let's say, in the standard, in reasonable dimensions. And in fact, for example, for the Large Hadron Collider, one of the options for the future, for upgrading the Large Hadron Collider, is to replace all the magnets with more powerful magnets that will allow to go, keeping the same circumference, to higher energies. But not so high, maybe a factor of 2 with respect to what we have nowadays.
Can I ask a question?
Yes.
See, 8 Tesla is for which center of momentum energy? Is it for 14 or for 7 or for 8 or for choosing energy?
No, Tesla is the magnetic field that you can achieve measured in the center of the magnet, the position where the beam passes. This is a unit of magnetic field that you can achieve.
The 8 Tesla. Ah. 8 Tesla, obviously. Dipole magnet. Is it the magnetic field for 14 electron volts?
8 Tesla is for about 8 TeV in the UHC. Yes. So the moment we have per beam, we have I think 8. How much? So
13. And I'll tell them that if I can explore.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
And in the past, when it was operating at 8,
in fact, is the reason why, because when it was running at lower energy, it was running at lower field in the magnets and lower current in the superconducting magnet. So for precaution, say, okay. We say, so superconducting magnets, we can go up to 8 or let's say double with new types of magnets. Superconductivity has been the last major development in the field of particle accelerators. So it's been more and more applied to superconductivity, although was discovered very early in 1911, only since the 70s started to be applied to particle accelerators. And only in the last, let's say, 20 years, there has been a boom of accelerators based on superconducting magnets and or superconducting RF cavities for acceleration. So what you can use here are examples of the DC magnet superconducting cable. We have a sample outside that you can see, the real one. You can have pictures of superconducting RF cavities that are used for acceleration. Those are also very useful because they do not dissipate power, so you can reach not higher electrical efficiency, but also in some cases higher gradient. So a larger number of megavolts per meter thanks to superconductivity. But behind that, you need a huge cryo system that keeps your magnets or your cavities cold at superconducting temperature. 1.8 Kelvin is what you need for these kind of things. And this is something which is very expensive. So, for example, the efficiency of your accelerator is very high, but that your overall efficiency is maybe higher, but you don't gain really that much because behind you have these kind of huge systems that are required to keep everything at cryogenic temperatures. Another comment is that another problem with our big accelerator is in dealing with energy, because if you calculate the energy of one LHC beam at high energy, we are at about 320 million joules. So the energy of a TGV train going at 150 kilometers per hour. And this all concentrated in a tiny particle beam. It is something which is really amazing. So we have seen that. And I have one more remark to make. For you to understand what is the LHC, because LHC stands for Large Hadron Collider. Large, we have seen why it is large, 27 kilometers. For the moment, is considered large. Maybe one day we'll call it Small Hadron Collider, SHC. We will have a new large one. Hadron, because protons and nuclei are hadrons. And the DHC accelerates protons or heavy ions, so it is a large hadron. But why collider? Collider is interesting because you can have, as in DHC, two flows of particles in opposite directions. So if you look again at the superconducting magnet of DHC, you see two holes, so two beam pipes. So actually the beam, you see here a section, goes in one direction here and goes out in the other direction. So in this way, inside the same ring, you can have two circulating beams that have few intersections on their length where they can intersect to each other. And this is where the experiments are placed. The experiments, they want to see the new particles that are produced, not created by the collisions. And so you need the collisions. You need to intersect the two beams. and it's a way to control the part, the places where you have the collisions, but also to reach higher energies. Why? Because you can have two ways of using the energy of your particles. Either you send your particles against the target, so against the block of material, which is basically this one. Fixed target, and so you can calculate the energy that is available that is developed in the collision, which is proportional to the square root of the energy of your particle beam. But thanks again to relativity, Mr. Einstein helps us a lot. A collider is much more efficient. So if we collide two particles with the same energy, one against the other, the energy developed in the collision is much higher. So you gain much more than a factor of two by building colliders. And this is the format we have to use, and this all the energy of the collision will be available for particle production, while here only a part of the energy is available for particle production. So this is why we like to build colliders. And this is how the Snell accelerator complex works, and this is what we've seen. Now, I come to another subject. Very good. So we build the LHC, but what else can we do with particle accelerators? There are plenty of things that you can do. And this is only just a short list of all the industrial applications of accelerators. You can do material processing. You can improve polymers. You can sterilize. You can kill microorganisms. You can treat in this way wastewater. You can even, it is not in this list, but you can clean fumes, smokes from coal power stations. You can remove the sulfur from the nitrogen from the fumes of a power station. You can do testing, non-destructive testing, carbon inspection, ion implantation, we mentioned, and production of isotopes, neutron testing. So there is a complete list of things, and I want to give you just a few short overview. Ion implantation, how to dope semiconductors, you can use an ion accelerator, and this way you can define what is the doping material, what is the element that you introduce in the crystal of the semiconductor. You can decide the amount of impurities that you introduce, and also the depth at which you introduce them, calibrating the energy of this accelerator. And it is not by surprise that more than 10,000 of this type of ion implanters, most of them are installed in Asia, where they make the semiconductors, and they use this technology for controlling the doping of the semiconductors. I want to say a few words on particle therapy of cancer, which is also something which that is really very rapidly developing nowadays in Europe and worldwide. So in this very same moment, there is another presentation by one of my colleagues in another place, just 1 hour only on particle therapy. Now I will give you everything in 1 minute, but what is the idea? The idea, as we say, is that a particle beam is like a knife that can penetrate but also can deliver your energy at a certain depth. This thanks to what is called the Bragg peak that you can see here in red for protons or carbon ions. Basically, the interaction between your particle beam and any matter is low at the beginning, and only when you have slowed down your beam then you start to deliver energy, which means that it's an ideal way to treat, for example, tumors that are very, very deep tumors that are very difficult to access. So you can selectively deposit your energy on the tumor, and this technique is as effective as normal radiotherapy. Usually doctors use a lot of radiotherapy, which is made with electron in an accelerator, again, but with small systems. Here you need a big system because you have to reach 200 MeV energy, for example, for protons, but you can select the depth, you can spare the surrounding tissues, because this is the curve for X-rays. You see the energy is deposited mostly on the skin, and then less and less the more you penetrate inside the body. So what is deposited really on the tumor is relatively small, and you have quite a lot of energy that is deposited elsewhere. So in fact, what they do, the doctors, they do the treatment from different directions in order to minimize the dose that is given outside of the tumor. But this is still something which is not so easy to do. And in particular, therapy with particle beams, with protons, is useful if you have vital organs next to a tumor. Because in this case, you can spare the vital organ, avoid to irradiate parts that are not in the tumor. So this is an example of what you can do with the energy deposited with 9 X-ray beams and with only four proton or carbon ion beams, you can have a better distribution of your energy inside the tumor zone, which is this one here. So particle therapy, it's developing. We have, I think, 19 facilities now in Europe for particle therapy. It's, let's say, not many in the sense that there are 3 or 4 facilities in Germany, for example, because the cost is very high. The cost is very high, but it allows to treat selected patients that really can profit from proton therapy. And it's also something which is really quickly developing. There are more and more facilities in the world using particle beams to treat tumors. In the same way, you can use particle accelerators to produce isotopes. You can produce isotopes for scanning. So PET scanners in the hospitals use an electron positron creating a reaction. So you inject a tracer with some isotopes that then decay inside the body. So some substances are accumulated, for example, over a tumor. Then these isotopes decay, they emit electrons and positrons, and you can detect them with an array of detectors. And this allows to make really a picture of a human part, of a tumor, for example, or any type of things that are of use for the doctors. And these isotopes are now made by cyclotron accelerators, usually in large production centers. And there is quite a lot of activity now in trying to develop small, compact accelerators that can make the isotopes in the hospital. So you don't need to transport the isotopes from the production center to the hospitals. And you can have the scanner and the reader accelerator next to it. So this is an example of a design that has been developed in Spain for a very compact accelerator for the production of radioisotopes. And also at CERN, we are working on something interesting. We have some designs to produce isotopes, but we have recently started the development of a miniature accelerator for cultural heritage. Because just with a small accelerator with only 1 meter in length, you can, and 100 kilograms of weight, you can make a 2 MeV particle beam that can be sent to an object. You can then analyze with the so-called Pixie technique, the X-rays emitted by the object, and then deduce the chemical composition, the amount of heavy elements on the surface of the object. If you use it for a painting, for example, then you can have an analysis of the paint, and you can immediately understand when it was painted, because the chemical composition of the paints changed a lot with time. So you can see if it is a fake of a real painting. What we are developing at CERN is something which we want to be portable. You can go, for example, on a large painting, on a fresco, and see not only if it is a fake, but, for example, if it was restored at different ages. This can be used for gemstones, for example, to see from which mines ancient gemstones are originated. So at the moment, there is only one museum in the world, the Louvre in Paris, and they have an accelerator in the basement of the museum. And I think that the Louvre is closed on Tuesdays, and on Tuesday, they take artifacts from the shelves, they go to the basement, they do this kind of analysis with the accelerator, and then they bring them back for when the visitors would come again the next day. And what we are now want to develop at CERN is something which is portable, can be used only by, also by small museums or to analyze artifacts that you cannot transport. You cannot go to the laboratory. So there are plenty of applications, but this is only a part, for example, of the work that I wanted to mention to build the miniature accelerator. So it's one of the interesting challenges, I believe, for accelerators. Some of my colleagues want to make it bigger and bigger. And okay, also small is beautiful. Small is beautiful because there is a challenge now. So we want to build what we call the compact RFQ 1 meter for this analysis of artwork. I've shown you this small, compact, superconducting cyclotron. And there is even people working for accelerator on a chip that can be in a shoebox. I've seen last week an image of a new project which is basically an American and German collaboration where they want to use new techniques based on dielectric acceleration at terahertz frequency, excited by lasers, and everything should fit really, something like that. Can we build it one day? I don't know. But this is one of the interesting challenges of accelerators. And it's interesting that because anyhow, we are going to be late, because the miniature accelerator exists already in the virtual world, because one day my daughter was playing with The Sims. I don't know if you know it. It's not a computer game. It's a simulation game where you build your own building, your own house. You keep everything. You can keep your apartment with what you want in this game. And she called me, "Look, Dad, in this The Sims, what I can buy for $125. I can buy the world's smallest, cheapest particle accelerator. Forge new subatomic particles in the comfort and privacy of your home." Warning, incorrect use may destroy the planet. So I told my daughter, great, so apart destroying the planet, these are exactly the specifications of my last project. So very good. So my conclusion is that if fantasy can imagine it, we have to make it. And so this is one of the challenges for the future accelerator. Okay, thank you for your attention.